Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the 6th Eastman Institute International Alliance Global Rounds. My name is Cyril Meyerowitz. I'm a faculty member at the Eastman Institute in Rochester and the University of Rochester. These presentations or these rounds represent an alliance of the Eastmans across the world from Stockholm, from London, from Rome, and from Rochester. And as I said, we've already had 5 of these before, roughly every 3 months, and this is the 6th. We have a very distinguished panel of speakers today who represent the leadership of the Eastmans in the 4 institutions that I mentioned. A few housekeeping items. There is at the bottom of your screen a question and answer tab. And while the speakers are speaking, you can put a question in. I will be asking as many questions as I can to the speakers, and they will field your questions as we go along. At the end of the session, there will be an evaluation or a poll. This evaluation poll is important because if you complete it, you have access to your continuing education credits, which will be sent to you. And this is for everybody all over the globe. The speakers today will have 22 minutes. During that 22 minutes, they will provide their presentation in 15 to 20 minutes, and there'll be some time for questions. So without further ado, and without a lot of pomp and ceremony about the titles of these people, that are quite extensive, I'm going to introduce them simply by name. And we're going to start first with our representative from Stockholm, Carina Kruger-Vena, who's going to give a presentation on endoscopic surgery in young patients with juvenile idiopathic arthritis engaging the temporomandibular joint. So Carina, it's all yours.
Okay, thank you. First, I would like to thank you all for the invitation and also for the highly appreciated initiative from Eastman Rochester for organizing these rounds. I'm an oral maxillofacial surgeon and associate professor and head of oral and maxillofacial surgery at the Folktandvården Eastman Institute at Karolinska Institutet, Stockholm, Sweden. This is our beautiful institute in Stockholm, inaugurated in 1936 and situated in the central part of Stockholm in close vicinity to the Vasa Park. The building harbors all the 9 different odontological specialties. The Eastman Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery Departments covers the polyclinic and outpatient surgery care, and we are coexisting in a multidisciplinary environment within the Institute, the Karolinska Institute, and Karolinska Hospital. Areas of major interest is advanced dento-alveolar surgery, reconstruction and implant surgery, infection and pathology. We also hold postgraduate education within the discipline and are involved in several research projects in close collaboration with, of course, the Karolinska Institute, but also Malmö Högskola and Bergen University in Norway. And you see pictures of some of my colleagues at Eastman. Arthroscopy is endoscopic surgery and has developed as a treatment modality for internal derangement, osteoarthritis, chronic inflammatory arthritis, and conditions related to the temporomandibular disc, such as disc displacement without reduction or chronic closed lock. Outcome of arthroscopy in the relation to osteoarthritis, juvenile arthritis, or chronic inflammatory arthritis have rarely been studied before. It is considered as a safe and non-invasive method. We enter into the superior joint compartment with 1 or 2 canicula, rinse through the joint with saline, and visualize the tissue through the scope. We can diagnose pathology and inflammation. The procedure is technically demanding, and even more so in young patients. Their joints are superficial, the operating area is small, and just below the skull base. we are in close contact with some anatomical structures of importance, like the temporal artery, the facial and trigeminous nerves, the ear canal, etc. During surgery, the upper joint compartment is flushed with sterile saline, thereby reducing inflammation and inflammatory mediators, lower pain, and increased mobility and functions. It can be performed in local or general anesthesia with leases and lavage. Complications are rare, but of course, nerve damages, bleeding, infection, airway threat, and hearing loss is some of the rare complications. This is some one of our major fields of research is the temporomandibular joint surgery. And listed here are the most recent publications within the field of arthroscopic surgery. All these studies were performed in an adult population. Biopsies analyzed for inflammatory cytokines were taken through the arthroscope from the retrodisc area of the temporomandibular joint. Juvenile idiopathic arthritis is an inflammatory autoimmune disease with unknown etiology and can possibly affect all the joints in the body, including the temporomandibular joint. It debuts before 16 years of age and is diagnosed with rheumatology criteria. Trigger can be trauma or infection, and in late stages give rise to craniomandibular growth disturbances like facial asymmetry and bite opening. It can be asymptomatic and therefore lead to late treatment and diagnosis, especially in children with engagement of the temporomandibular joint. This can affect their growth and their ability to participate in normal life. In literature, as much as 40 to 96% engaged the temporomandibular joint. Symptoms are pain, reduced mouth opening, trismus malocclusion, and growth disturbances. Sweden is a small country with only 10 million inhabitants, but we have approximately 200 to 250 cases per year and 50 referrals to the orofacial pain and jaw function department at the Eastman Institute. It's a multidisciplinary approach, rheumatology, orofacial pain and jaw function specialists, and in some cases, the oral and maxillofacial surgeons. Of course, orthodontics and prosthodontics are involved, engaged in the rehabilitation procedures. Treatment is a combination of rheumatologic medication, immune suppressants, biological anti-inflammatory drugs, and corticosteroids. This in combination with physiotherapy, splints, local injections, and in rare cases, temporomandibular joint surgery. Systemic therapy is frequently ineffective in controlling the temporomandibular joint disease in this group, and there is a lack of knowledge and more research is indeed needed. Around this project is a strong collaboration with some of my colleagues, both here at Eastman and at other institutes. Like Professor Bodil Lund, who's at the University of Bergen, Norway, and Karolinska Institute. Professor Britt Hedenberg Magnusson, who's already given a speech in this international round. And Lars Fredriksson, senior consultant or facial pain and jaw specialist at Eastman. And my colleague, Dr. Ho-Yun Cho, who's doing together with me, performing the arthroscopic surgery. And also Dr. Sara Shamoon, who's a dentist with a master thesis within this project. In Stockholm, a vast majority of the patients with juvenile idiopathic arthritis are treated by the orofacial pain and jaw function specialist here at Eastman, and they are also responsible for this group. In collaboration with them, we offer a less invasive arthroscopy and arthrocentesis as a treatment choice when general conservative and pharmaceutical treatment fails. We use a thin, narrow, and short arthroscope and with very gentle handling due to the risk of damaging the sensitive tissues and interfering with growth. Only gentle rinsing with saline to minimize surgical trauma. Surgery is performed in general anesthesia at a nearby hospital and in an outpatient setting. We can use the method for diagnostic purposes as well, and as a safe and controlled arthrocentesis with promising results. When inside the joints, we can eject corticosteroids when suitable and if needed. We have been following a small number of GI patients after arthroscopic surgery. Summarized here are only 5 patients, but since then we can add another 7 patients to this group. In this group, here they are, they were all female, and as you can see, experienced a relief in subjective pain and increased function of the temporomandibular joint. We find these results encouraging and promising, although not to forget, this is a very limited number of patients. Next step is now to evaluate the method in a randomized controlled study. The hypothesis is that by doing minimal invasive arthroscopy, we can reduce inflammation and pain and increase the time frame for recurrences. During the last 4 years since we started at Eastman, we have treated more than 60 young patients, but only 12 patients with juvenile arthritis. But we do believe that a number of patients among those 60 will later on get the juvenile arthritis diagnosis. Included patients are those with suboptimal outcome of standard treatment. By visualizing their joints through the arthroscope, we have made some clinical observations. These patients differ from adult population of rheumatology patients. They express more subjective pain, pain in function and rest, with higher pain scale values than adult rheumatology patients, who usually have numbers around 4 to 5. We find a more pronounced synovitis, but usually no signs of adheresis or fibroankylosis. This is an important exclusion criteria for us. Another is ASA3 or signs of bony ankylosis. If so, the arthroscope will not be able to reach into the upper chamber due to destruction and diminished joint space. These patients are referred to our colleagues at the Karolinska University Hospital for open surgery and eventually total joint replacement. Fortunately, with different combination of therapy, this is a very rare outcome. My case is a young girl who was referred to the orofacial pain and jaw function specialist here at Eastman when beginning orthodontic treatment. There is an orthodontic problem to address, deep bite and crowding together with signs of temporomandibular disorders. She had her diagnosis at 10 years of age, knees and back engaged. She's on a rheumatoid arthritis combination treatment, and at 13 years of age, she had signs of temporomandibular disorders. She suffers from myalgia and disc disturbances, reciprocal clicking and locking, and now developed into a chronic closed lock situation with signs of arthritis. She has difficulties to open her mouth and severe pain. Condition is confirmed with MRI and CBCT scans. And this, of course, affects her daily activities. CBCT scans show signs of osteoarthritis, remodelation, erosions. Her condylar heads are tiny, and we have the similar condition bilaterally, but symptoms are stronger on the right side. From the orofacial pain and jaw function specialist, she retrieves 2 injections with glucocorticosteroids, splints and physiotherapy. She responds well to this treatment and continues with orthodontic braces. After 18 months, a new referral, pain, limitations in mouth opening, and also symptoms from the left joint, disc related with clicking and pain. They prescribe anti-inflammatory drugs and she gets better, all this in combination with their standard rheumatology treatment. A few months passes and another relapse develops with recurrent arthritis. Now we as surgeons get consulted, and together with the orofacial pain specialist, the rheumatologist, we plan for right side arthroscopy. In surgery, we find pronounced severe synovitis, hyperemia with vessels migrating on the disc surfaces, cartilage ruptures both in the glenoid fossa and on the disc surface. I should remind you that healthy joint has white, smooth surfaces that are non-vascularized. Patient experience a relief of symptoms, less pain, and to some extent increased function. She's got no complications of surgery. But she begins to get side effects now by her rheumatic medication. She gets nauseous and difficult to eat. And she's soon to be discussed again in another multidisciplinary round. A challenge with arthroscopy in this patient group is the fluctuations in general disease activity, and the treatment with disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs should be optimized. This is a chronic disease with recurrent relapses. The timing of the surgery, we believe it's important. We prefer to operate while the patient suffers from recurrent arthritis to get the most out of surgery. This is, of course, challenging for the clinic. We believe that arthroscopy could be performed during relapse to optimize the effect. Our arthrocentesis is less invasive than the arthroscopy, while sharp needles are used. An advantage is that we can do surgery under local anesthesia with sedation. We are concerned if we are traumatizing the vulnerable joint of a growing individual, but so is also the injections of corticosteroids, debated whether they themselves destroy the joint and give rise to growth disturbances. We see very promising results, but what is the long-term effect? Can we increase duration between the relapses? Can we reduce the number of relapses and thereby increase the possibilities for these young patients to live a less painful life? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karina. Excellent presentation. I don't see any questions on the Q&A. Sometimes people have a little difficulty where they start out in the morning or later on. So let me turn to the other panelists to ask if there are any questions. Actually, I'm seeing a question just come right now. So let me give you this question, Karina. It's from Abdullah left, and he asks, is there any significant difference between different arthrocentesis medicaments, sodium hyaluronate, normal saline, corticosteroid, and different anesthetics? So he's asking, are there any differences between these medications?
As far as I know, not in literature, and I haven't been studied. We only use saline for this.
Okay.
So not as far as I know, no.
Does anybody on the panel want to comment on that question?
I've got a similar question. Do you ever use morphine intra-articularly? I usually put that as a standard at the end of the operation. I use balloon dilatation with an angioplasty catheter. And then when I finished, I just put four milligrams each side. If you give 10 milligrams, patients tend to vomit. But I wonder if you've had any practice with that.
Okay, I mean, they get morphine by the end of the surgery, but we also we inject local anesthesia not into the joint, but on the outside of the joint, we put local anesthesia with long duration, like 6 to 7 hours duration. That will of course affect the facial nerve. I mean, but they are informed about that in before. And the strange thing is that we very rarely experience that these patients need to call the hospital or to call us due to pain afterwards, but they are on morphine like during the first 24 hours after surgery. But I never put morphine inside the joint.
Antonia, Dr. Collins.
So there have been a couple of systematic reviews and meta-analysis on the subject, and there have been no differences between the type of fluids used for irrigation of the joint. Mostly is the, I think the majority concentrate on the amount than the type, as well as no differences in regards to injection. I saw the question is about hyaluronic acid, sodium hyaluronic versus corticosteroids. And again, I believe the literature does not support either of the two.
No.
Would anybody want to comment? Karina, why don't you start, but anybody else on the long-term success? You obviously mentioned that you want to follow these long-term. And there is a question about the long-term success.
What we can see now in this, because it's some time has been passing now, and we see a long-term effect of these. I mean, some of the this is a very limited number of patients, but some of these, a few of these patients, we haven't been urged to repeat atherosynthesis. In two or three of these in this group, we've been repeating, but the long-term effect has been up to 1 year. But this is also why we would like to go further on this randomized control study, because we want to follow them at least 6 months. I've been doing this arthroscopic treatment in adult population and osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis, and it in fact you can see a long-term effect, but I think the good effect here is that we are being able to do it during the relapse, so we are doing the treatment when they have their recurrence, because in the hospital I used to work with this in the Karolinska hospital, and then we have to wait for such a long time. I mean, there could be 1, 2, 3 months before we did surgery. So I think the key here is that we can do it within 2-3 weeks.
Okay, excellent. We're going to need to go on. By the way, that question came from Emile Rousseau, who's the chairman of orthodontics here in Rochester. I do want to just add for everybody, I noticed on your slide, Karina, that you had Karolinska Institute, that all the Eastmans are in fact either part of or linked to pretty large educational institutions, universities. In the case of Stockholm, it's Karolinska. In the case of London, it's there within University College of London, and many of the PU faculty are faculty of UCL. In the case of Rochester, it's the, or Eastman in Rochester, it's the University of Rochester. And now in the case of the Eastman in Rome, it's the University of Sapienza. So let's continue now with our next presentation. We're very fortunate to have Antonia Kolakitas. From the University of Rochester, Eastman, Rochester, and Dr. Kolakitas is going to speak to us about advances in the management of oral cancer. Thank you.
Good morning and good afternoon to everybody, and thank you for the kind invitation to be part of this wonderful panel of colleagues across the world. Well, mostly across the Atlantic, but... So I decided to talk about advances in the management of oral cancer, and for the majority of the audience of in this discussion, you know that this cannot be covered in 22 minutes, but it's going to be an overview of what's kind of new. And traditionally, head and neck cancer has been studied and reported as an organ, and really head and neck is not an organ. We discuss all the cases at head and neck multidisciplinary tumor boards, all the teams are multidisciplinary, but head and neck is multiple subsites. And every subsite, the nasopharynx, the oropharynx, the orocavity, the larynx, have very distinct representation in regards to cancers and in regards to treatment and treatment responses. So I decided to cover the orocavity cancer, specifically squamous cell carcinoma, as that makes about 95% of the head and neck cancers is squamous cell carcinoma, because first of all, is the one that is of interest to me and is the one that a lot of advances may have happened or changes. So I will touch briefly on demographic updates, diagnosis and workup updates, and treatment updates. Perhaps this is a montage of some of patients that present today, and the gentleman to the top of the, I don't know if everybody can see my cursor, but this is a Catholic priest. This is a Muslim woman. This is a 17 years old patient. And if I were to put them in a different presentation, these patients don't fit the criteria to have oral cancer. Yet, these are the oral cancer faces of today. This is some of my patients who did not necessarily have traditional risk factors, did not really fit the bill for having oral cancer. So in regards to demographics, what has changed in the incidence among white men, among women, among those without traditional risk factors, let's say the traditional non-smokers, non-drinkers? Well, all these incidences have increased. And those who had had it worse are the white men, and they had an increase of oral cancer up to 5.1%. In women, that increase is a little bit less, it's only 0.6%. But there's an increase among those without traditional risk factors, non-smokers, non-drinkers in the mid-50s on both groups. This is evident by the American Cancer Society statistics. They estimate new cases for 2020, and all these statistics obviously have a couple of years of delay in the reporting. And you can see oral cavity and pharynx are lumped together. That's a little bit of a problem, but in this category, the majority of cancers are in the oral cavity for the United States. The estimated new cases for male is almost 39,000, and for females, about 15,000. What is worrisome and troublesome is the number of deaths among these patients. And among males, that number is pretty significant. And among females, continues to be on the rise. And that's independent of treatment. That's very important to keep in mind. The estimated deaths are not report based on treatment that these patients received. What about HPV and oral cancer? Well, HPV is still detected in a high number of oral cancers, but there has been really no involvement or changes in regards to how these cancers are treated based on their HPV status. This is different from the laryngeal cancers and oropharynx cancers, that now HPV is part of the staging and impacts treatment. For the oral cavity, although very often HPV is detected, there has been no changes in regards to staging or alteration in treatments. What about diagnosis and workup? The traditional and still the standard of care is to obtain tissue for histopathologic confirmation of the cancer. None of us come equipped with microscope in our eyes. I say that to my patients all the time. Our experience can confirm or allow us to be very certain that a certain lesion can be cancerous, but we still require histopathologic confirmation. And that remains the same. An H&E slide, look for the squamous cells, look for the keratin pearls, give the grading of the squamous cell carcinoma. And sometimes the biopsy may require multiple sites, may require ultrasound guided biopsies if the mass is in the neck, versus open biopsy, obviously, if it's something in the oral cavity. It is important during the biopsy, and there's a little controversy, mostly for academic purposes, if you should include normal tissue or just obtain the tissue sample from within the tumor. Well, that depends. The biopsy, at least in my hands and the majority of the specialists, the biopsy is to confirm the presence of the cancer. And you will see this later in the presentation to discuss about depth of invasion. So I really do not need normal tissue to tell me that something is cancer. The transition between the squamous cell carcinoma and the normal epithelium is far more important when it comes to dysplasia, perhaps, but not to frank cancer. But if you have a lesion that is ulcerated and you obtain tissue from within the ulceration, occasionally the pathologist will have really hard time indicating with certainty that the tissues are actually malignant due to the presence of the ulceration, due to the presence of potentially yeast superinfection. This remained a little bit challenging to them. So for friable, quiet ulcerated lesions, perhaps it's easier to obtain tissue from what appears to be the junction between the normal and the transition into the malignancy. When it comes to imaging, CT and MRI remain the standard and the preferred imaging for staging of the cancers of the oral cavity. The reason to choose one versus the other is usually the dental artifacts from a lot of dental work, fillings, crowns, and things like that, that very often distort the images on the CAT scan. For lesions of the floor of the mouth or the tongue, that becomes a little bit more problematic, and perhaps an MRI is a more highly desirable. Of course, the MRI, it will not be very useful in demonstrating bony invasion, and for those reasons, a CT scan will be superior. All these are obtained with contrast, and of course, the images extend into the neck, and sometimes we obtain chest images to look for distant metastasis. But CT and MRI of the head and neck down to the clavicles is the standard workup for these patients. Again, the metastatic workup depends on the staging. PET scan for advanced stage disease and recurrences. This is the application for this technology. It uses a radioisotope, glucose that is uptaken by tissues that have high metabolic activity. So of course, cancer cells will pick up the glucose. It's useful, again, when we have metastatic disease or we have recurrences or in cases where we have complex reconstruction in the postoperative evaluation of the patients or the surveillance visits. In our country, it's not approved necessarily for the primary imaging unless there is a CT scan or an MRI that is not conclusive. Let me back up for 1 second. PET scan is often used for unknown primaries when there is a neck mass that is confirmed to be positive for squamous cell carcinoma, and the endoscopy has not demonstrated any primary disease. And at that point, a PET scan may assist in identifying the area of the primary if that exists. And usually those are in the oropharynx. What has changed in the TNM staging? TNM stands for tumor, nodes, and metastasis. So what has changed in the 8th edition for the oral cavity is the addition of the depth of invasion. So the depth of invasion has been added to the staging, and what that has created is an upstage for early tumors. So traditionally, the stage for oral cancers is 0 to 2 centimeters is stage is T1, over 2 to 4 is T2, and go on. Now with a depth of invasion, any tumor over with a depth of invasion of 3 millimeters and over is considered T2, so that's an upstage. That has impacted our approach to these patients. We do not know the long-term effects, quote unquote, of this upstaging because the system is relatively new. So I spoke earlier about where do you obtain tissue for histopathologic diagnosis, and it's very easy to obtain tissue from some of these lesions, but for example, on this tongue lesion with the center area of ulceration, anything from the center may not be very helpful to the pathologist for confirmation of the histopathology. Something exophytic like this on the upper right side of the screen can be confused with a verrucous lesion that's not necessarily cancerous. So sometimes how deep the biopsy goes is critical to the pathologist as well. Now, to incorporate the next anatomic layer in the biopsy sometimes is more challenging. So the pathologist will report back that an incisional biopsy, perhaps the tumor extends to the margins. Well, that makes really no difference as it was only meant to obtain tissue for diagnosis. In regards to treatment, for us who are surgeons and who are interested in head and neck cancer, the surgery remains the primary treatment modality for oral cancers and early stages, especially for early stages disease. For other sides of the head and neck, chemoradiotherapy may be the primary treatment of choice, but for the oral cavity, surgery is the preferred and the primary treatment offered. What about chemo XRT? So there are two ways of administering radiation and chemotherapy. One is scalp induction that is given prior to surgery, has very limited role to the head and neck, and I'll explain this in a little bit, versus post-surgery, which is considered adjuvant treatment. Rarely for the head and neck, if we have a very fast-growing tumor on an unhealthy patient that requires optimization prior to surgery, we select to order to perform a few rounds of radiation to assess if there is any tumor response. Again, very select cases, very case specific. These are discussed at the tumor board. The patient is not a good surgical candidate. The circumstances are such that the tumor has grown really fast, and sometimes the decision is, do we go the palliative route and elect hospice versus trying to see if the radiation will stop the growth of the disease. Later on, these cases are reassessed for eligibility for resection. Usually these patients do poorly. So in general, induction chemoradiotherapy has no role in the oral cancer patient. For postoperatively, there are specific indications which we'll discuss. So for radiotherapy, it is considered the required adjuvant therapy. And the best results are for cancers that have early metastatic disease, nodal metastasis. So early nodal disease is considered the pathologic N1 when there is only one lymph node with no extracapsular extension, no other adverse features. Advanced stage 3 and 4 cancers without nodal involvement or with early nodal involvement, and again, no adverse features. When we start having advanced nodal disease and adverse features such as extracapsular extension, perineural invasion, or disease involvement at lower levels in the neck, then the adjuvant therapy offered is and recommended is the chemoradiotherapy. Again, those adverse features are considered the extracapsular extension, even for a single lymph node, presence of perineural invasion, meaning cancer around named nerves, and lymphovascular invasion. Of course, positive margins, which is considered an adverse feature, require re-excision. That is the ideal. Occasionally, that's not possible. And thus, chemoradiotherapy is the preferred adjuvant therapy. When we refer to extracapsular extension, we ensure that we're not talking about microscopic disease. We're talking about frank extracapsular extension. What is a positive margin? Well, positive margin in oral cancer and in head and neck cancer means that there is at least either carcinoma in situ or invasive squamous cell carcinoma at the resection margin. When the clearance between the tumor front and normal tissue is less than 5 millimeter, that is reported as a close margin. And why is that important? That is important because patients have shown to do significantly worse when there is either involved margin, positive margin, or closed margins. So patients who had, there's one systematic review meta-analysis that demonstrated that patients who have at least over 5 millimeter clearance between the tumor front and normal tissues did statistically significantly better than those that had closer margins or involved margins in the 5-year disease-free survival, and that's important, regardless of treatment. So need to address the lymphatics. When do we do that? Well, there are a couple of ways that we can address the lymphatics. One is with surgery, and that is in the form of a neck dissection. And there used to be a lot of ways to refer to the neck dissection: supraomohyoid, selective, modified radical, radical. We have all agreed nowadays that neck dissection is on an N0 neck when there is no clinical and radiographic evidence of disease. That neck dissection is referred to as elective neck dissection or selective neck dissection. And then we report the levels 1 through 3, 1 through 4, 2, 2, 4. So we're getting away from all these names that that we used to use in the past. An elective neck dissection is a neck dissection performed, again, when there is no evidence of disease in the neck. When there is evidence of disease, that is considered a therapeutic neck dissection. And sometimes with that therapeutic neck dissection, other structures are included, for example, the sternocleidomastoid muscle or the jugular vein, but only if these are frankly involved by tumor. There is no indication at, nowadays to sacrifice the spinal accessory nerve. We used to be pretty routine when the neck dissections were introduced. Alternatively, radiation can be used for the nodes of the neck, but that is preserved for patients who are either too sick to undergo surgery or they elect not to have a neck dissection. When can the neck dissection be addressed? At the time of the primary resection or postoperatively. For example, during the pandemic, we had a few patients who were borderline meet the criteria for neck dissection, but in the interest of performing, removing the primary, having the full assessment of the specimen, they had the primary section first, and then a few weeks later, a month later, had the neck dissection. That is an option. That would be an example of a neck dissection, a supraomohyoid neck dissection on levels 1 through 3. You can appreciate the jugular vein is preserved, the carotid artery obviously is preserved, the sternocleidomastoid muscle is preserved, and the spinal accessory nerve is preserved. The omohyoid muscle, which you see down here, is the delineation of levels 3 and 4. And for the oral cavity, the more anterior the lesion is, the less the need to go to down to 4 versus posterior lesions or more bulky disease, you have to include 4. There's really a reason to remove level 5 or 6 of the nerve, of the neck. When the primary can be removed separately or is safe to remove separately, then the primary is submitted, like in this picture, separately and oriented, and the neck is submitted separately. I have a tendency not to divide the levels. I submit them as one specimen, and I mark my levels so the pathologist can give me back if there was a positive lymph node at level 1 up here or versus level 4 down there. When the primary requires composite resection, we keep it in continuity with the neck, and you can appreciate the specimen is tongue, mandible, floor of the mouth, and bilateral neck dissections. And on the right side, because there was already disease process, the sternocleidomastoid muscle is part of the disease, part of the specimen. When the neck is positive radiographically or with histology confirmation, then in addition to the neck dissection, the need for postoperative chemo XRT is discussed and offered based on the stage and the presence of adverse features on the final pathology. And this would be an example of an MRI with a bulky disease in the neck and an example of a CT scan with destruction of the bone that will make these patients at least stage 4 disease. What about N0 neck? If there is a risk for occult nodal disease, meaning if the risk of having disease that we cannot predict clinically or radiographically, that is over 20%, then the neck has to be treated again, either with surgery or radiotherapy. And there are other things that we take into consideration that I mentioned earlier. Probably the most changes in the management of oral cancer have been the treatment. In the treatment has been the reconstruction. So this used to be the cancer patient of the past, the anti-gum deformity that some of you may have heard already, where there's extensive resections, no reconstruction. This is not the case today. Or patients who had bone resection and they were only reconstructed with soft tissues. And after their chemoradiotherapy, their hardware has gone through other soft tissues. Again, these are not the cases of today. With a free tissue transfer, that gives us the ability to reconstruct any defect. And with the ability to plan reconstruction with virtual surgical planning, our results are, we have the ability to reconstruct both form and function. So this would be the oral cancer patient of the millennium. This is a lady with a subtotal maxillectomy. Postoperatively, she received chemoradiotherapy. She received zygoma implants with virtual surgical planning, and this is her face. This is my young girl with a composite resection of the right mandible, chemoradiotherapy, fibula free flap reconstruction, and she can live a normal life. So I consider this the new face of the oral cancer patient of the new millennium. And this is the end of my talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kolokitas. We don't have too much time, but I would like to give the other panelists an opportunity at least to make some very, very brief comments or questions if they wish. And if you're going to respond, please make it very, very brief, Antonia, so we can move on. Thank you. Any comments or Colin, Dr. Hopper from?
Just one comment and one quick question, very briefly. We've recently been looking at oral cancer incidence in India, and it's interesting that HPV does not play a part in the massive number of cases they get there. That's just a comment. And the question really is, any strong views on sentinel node work?
So unfortunately, in the United States, this has not caught on with us. I know in Europe it's very common. We don't do it, and the reasons for it are not related to the ability of a sentinel lymph node to detect metastasis. It's a very good way of doing so. Our issues are really training and, truthfully, reimbursement.
Thank you. And we can take a break, because this is an interesting topic. Any other comments or questions from our panelists? Okay, hearing none, thank you very much for a great presentation. And we can move on to the next presentation by Mr. Colin Hopper from Eastman London and University College of London. Colin is going to give us a talk on persistent lymphadenopathy during molar endodontic treatment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just by way of background, I've been at the Eastman in London since 1986. I've been there an awful long time. My background is oral and maxillofacial surgery and more recent research interests in photodynamic therapy for cancer and infection. So the case I'm going to present today is a slightly unusual case of a neck swelling in a patient who is undergoing some endodontic therapy. We're not moving on very carefully. So the aims of this talk raise awareness of differential diagnoses of neck swellings and talk a little bit about the appropriateness of different diagnostic investigations and to try and avoid the pitfalls of delaying a diagnosis. Let's try that. So I'm going to present this case and then we're going to talk about the investigations and go on to the key discussion points. Okay. So this is the case in question. It's a 64-year-old male referred by his dentist. He'd been undergoing endo treatment on this lower premolar, which has been going quite well. The endodontist said, the neck swelling should settle down when the root filling is complete. After this had been going on for about 3 months and didn't seem to be getting any smaller, the dentist got a bit twitched and referred him for an opinion. relevant past medical history. He was a company director, went to the gym regularly, non-smoker, non-drinker, no medications. He was not the greatest historian in the world, and he seemed to block out a couple of key details, but I did manage to ascertain that he had had a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma about 12 and 14 years ago, treated with radiotherapy. He wasn't very forthcoming about anything else. So he came to see me, and the striking thing was, on extra oral examination, that he got a non-tender mass right to the neck. Just laying a finger on this straight away, you can. Intraoral examination didn't reveal much. He got a marked gag reflex, which made it a bit tricky. There was nothing around the implant and no tenderness around the premolar. The submandibular duct was draining normally, so there was nothing obvious going on intraorally. So at that stage, my working diagnosis was of a recurrent lymphoma. On the differential was malignancy from elsewhere, either primary or metastatic from outside the head and neck. And at the bottom of my list was reactive lymphadenopathy, which had been the working diagnosis up until that point. So how do we get to a diagnosis quickly in a patient like that? Well, I've phoned up my friendly neighborhood radiologist, who happened to have an ultrasound list that day, and arranged for him to have an ultrasound. This is non-invasive, it's very rapid. As I say, got it on the same day, relatively inexpensive. And you can also get fine needle aspirate cytology. So if you put your needle in here, this is a node here. This is the carotid artery. You can accurately get into a node without damaging anything else. And for the last 20 years, I've been very fortunate to work with Gabriella Kojan, who is a top cytopathological guru, who's bailed us out of many a difficult situation. However, we opted not to go down that route, and we opted to go down a slightly different route. Here's the ultrasound. You can see this is a big, juicy lymph node. There's no central necrosis, but the margins are certainly not in keeping with a normal lymph node, which is armored in shape. This is not normal by any stretch of the imagination. So rather than do a fine needle aspirate, which gives you some cells to look at, we actually went ahead and did a core biopsy at the time of presentation. So I saw him in the morning, and by the afternoon, he was found to have this unilateral enlargement of level 1A, 1B, 2A and 2B lymph nodes. The largest one was good going size, over 1.5 centimeters. And looking up from the bottom with the ultrasound, you could just see that the right tonsil was larger than the left. So without further ado, a little bit of local anesthetic was put in, and core biopsies were taken from the large node. And here is an example of a core biopsy. This is put in under ultrasound guidance. You fire this sheath down and it amputates a core of tissue. And this is what you get. We've got four cores, 15 millimeters long. And you can see there's already quite a lot of tissue there to do a bit more than make a cytological assessment. Here we can see these darkly stained areas. And I don't think you need to be a pathologist to realize that these are not normal. This is what is going wrong. If we look under higher power, you can see these morphological changes with cell crowding, nuclear changes, and all sorts of other features that make it very likely that it's a squamous cell carcinoma. Features of a lymphoma are not seen. So you've also got enough tissue with this to go on and do other tests. So immunostaining was undertaken, and CK5, P53 and P16 were all positive, which confirms that this is of squamous origin. EBA was negative, and that's a test to rule out metastatic nasopharyngeal cancer. But you can see these clearly pathological islands of tissue within the core biopsy. Now, we use a very similar staging, just been hearing all about staging. We rely an awful lot on ultrasound to stage the neck. So he's had his ultrasound. We use an MRI to show the primary site. The discussion about bone is interesting. Our radiologists say we're not interested in the bone, we're interested in the soft tissue in the bone. It's a fine point. The other thing about MRI is you can flip the sequences and get black bone. So MR can be not as good, but getting on to be as good as CT for seeing bone. We take a chest and abdo CT to exclude synchronous tumors. And as we heard earlier on, we might consider a PET MR or a PET CT if this were an unknown primary. So we then take the case to our MDT, our multidisciplinary meeting, which we have nice and regularly with radiologists, radiation oncologists, surgeons, clinical nurse specialists, speech terrorists, and all sorts of other people. It's a fairly big organization. Now here we can see one of the reasons why MR is limited. You can see this is dental artifact here, which is degrading the image. Here you can see this is low down on the tonsil. There's clear asymmetry at that level, indicating this is probably a tonsillar primary carcinoma. And here's the mass in the neck. You can see it's quite extensive, not involving the great vessels here at the back, but still pretty extensive. Interestingly, we took chest and abdo CT to rule out second primaries, but quite clearly there's a degree of cardiomegaly. The cardiac shadow should take up less than 50% of the thoracic area, and this is well over 50%. And this is atrial and ventricular enlargement, which is interesting in itself. So we've got this final diagnosis then of 2.8 by 1.9 by 1.9 tonsillar mass with nodal disease at various levels. I didn't show it on that sequence, but there was one other feature that was slightly worrying, which was there was a high retropharyngeal lymph node, which makes the treatment planning a little bit trickier. In terms of staging, this is staged as T2N1 if it's HPV positive. It's N2B if it's HPV negative. Now, we know from the various immunotests that he is in this group HPV positive, so it's downstaged. And we've got to bear in mind this right atrium and ventricular enlargement. So here we're going back to our working differential diagnosis. It's a malignant node, that much I was pretty confident about. I guessed wrong. I thought this was related to his lymphoma, but it wasn't. It was related to his tonsil. Metastasis from oropharynx or elsewhere is obviously high up on the differential. And in fact, the poor view of the oropharynx probably caused me to overlook what was quite a low down tonsillar tumor. Chances of it being a reactive lymph node secondary to endodontic treatment, I thought was highly unlikely in the absence of unconvincing periapical radiology. And there were no symptoms at all from inside the mouth. So where does that take us? Well, he needs a full investigation of his previous lymphoma treatment. He did seem to think he had had some radiotherapy. We're very vague about that. We think that he's had only cutaneous radiotherapy to a couple of areas of lymphoma, and that is not going to compromise the radiation fields for his current treatment. The interesting challenge with the cardiomegaly is we need to check his previous chemotherapy. Is there a possibility that they use some cardiotoxic drugs? So he is currently having a full cardiological workup. In terms of treatment, the primary chemo radiotherapy treatment for this would be our standard of care. There may be limitations from his previous treatment, but we think this is probably unlikely. If CRT is not possible for any reason, Then we're looking at salvage surgery, which would be tonsillar resection, neck dissection. But there's always the problem of dealing with a retropharyngeal node, which tends to suggest the disease is fairly extensive. So just the discussion points about this. It's unexplained lymphadenopathy. It's always important to, in the history, is this getting better? Is it getting worse? If it persists, especially if it's getting larger, it warrants further investigation, especially if it's firm and irregular, when one should always think malignancy. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Colin. Excellent presentation. I don't see any questions in the Q&A, so let me turn to the panelists and welcome Professor Valentini. We'll get to you in a little while. Are there any questions?
Hello.
Hi.
Any questions on the presentation? Comments? Tony?
Wonderful talk, and thank you for covering the ultrasound part. A comment and a question. Obviously, ultrasound, not many of us feel comfortable, in the United States at least, incorporating our routine exam, although it should be. It's very common in Europe, and it's like it is inviolable. The is pan endoscopy part of your workup for these patients? Okay, either so an office nasopharyngoscopy?
He's had nasopharyngoscopy. A formal EUA and multiple site biopsy, I don't think has been, we didn't consider that necessary given the radiological and pathological findings. The comment about ultrasound is really very diverse. I personally have never done ultrasound in the clinic as part of the head and neck clinic. However, I have insisted wherever possible that my senior trainees go on a training course to learn how to do it so they can incorporate it into their practice. And it's very common. I know in Germany, I'm not sure about Sweden, but it's quite common elsewhere. We have a slightly different take that all of our ultrasound is performed by a consultant or one of three consultants, all of whom are absolute wizards at and their reports are really meaningful. We talked about depth. You talked about depth assessment. We're now using core biopsies that are ultrasound guided intraorally at right angles to the surface to get an accurate depth assessment of tumor invasion. Once it's over 5, 6, 7 millimeters, something like that, it becomes a bit irrelevant. But certainly for the early tumors to decide on management of the neck, it's become quite good fun. Not a lot of this is published, but I do know that the published data from the ultrasound correlation with neck dissections shows that it's about 96% accurate or something like that. But it's very specialist.
It does require the right person. Otherwise, it's a useless study. Absolutely agree.
Couldn't agree more.
Mm-hmm. I fully agree. I mean, we are sharing or borrowing ultrasound from the oral pain and specialists, because they're using it for the temporomandibular joint. But we have a surgeon here at Eastman who's trained in Germany. That's why he's using it. And in our clinic, which is an outpatient care clinic, it's very useful because patients come first to us and then we kind of refer them further on and for infections and these things, and to exclude like swollen lymph nodes and things like that, it's perfect. It's non-invasive, it's very easy to do. But you need to be very trained to be able to use it.
Yeah, good comment. Okay, I mean, we're a little ahead, so that's good. If there's no other questions, any other comment or question? Thank you for a great presentation, Colin. So let's move ahead then to our colleagues from Rome, University of Sapienza and the Eastman. And we have Professor Valentini, I think I pronounced it right. And he's going to give us a talk on primary intraosseous carcinomas. So If you can go ahead and share your screen, we can go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, and good morning, dear colleagues. It's a great pleasure for me to be here today representing the Italian branch of Eastman Institute. I take the opportunity of this round to share our experience in the management of a case of primary intraosseous squamous cell carcinoma that represented a real challenge from diagnosis to treatment. Okay, this 49-year-old gentleman consulted his dental doctor for the appearance of dental mobility not related to any infectious disease and without other signs and symptoms. The patient does not have a history of alcohol and tobacco consumption, and no other relevant diseases were reported. At the physical examination, no epithelial oral lesions were detected, as well as dental decays. Mandible presents normal movements, and TNJ examination showed no alterations. Grade 3 mobility of 4.7 dental was the only finding. A mandibular dental scan was requested in order to reveal any bone alteration. As you can see, the scan revealed a unilocular cyst involving the dental element 4.7 and the impacted wisdom right tooth. The surrounding bone cortex presented signs of erosion and irregular distraction. Based on the suspicions of a dental cyst, teeth extraction and lesion removal was planned. Under local anesthesia, teeth extractions and cyst removal were performed. The patient's dental doctor chose to do not send the specimen to the pathologist based on the supposed diagnosis of follicular cyst. Unfortunately, 2 weeks after the operation, the patient still complained pain and swelling, not responding to primary medical treatments. Due to the lack of improvement, a diagnosis of dry socket was made. A socket revision and repeated surgical medications were performed. 3 months after initial treatments, the patient was finally referred to our center. The intraoral inspection revealed an ulcerative lesion rising from the extraction socket and involving the retromolar trigone, the posterolateral floor of the mouth, the vestibulum, and the cheek mucosa. Numbness of the mandibular nerve was presented. Trismus and painful lateral mandibular movements were also noted, as well as a painful swelling at right mandibular angle region covered by erythematosus and fixed skin. Finally, neck palpation showed a firm mass of 1.5 centimeters of diameter at level 1 and 2B. Due to the high suspicions of a malignant disease, a whole body contrast enhancement CT was requested. An infiltrative mass with large bone distraction and masseter muscle infiltration was shown, along with multiple ipsilateral high suspicious pathological neck nodes. After that, an intraoral incisional biopsy was performed that confirmed the diagnosis of an high-grade squamous cell carcinoma that, in consideration of the peculiar clinical history and pre-extraction imaging findings, could be considered as a primary mandibular intraosseous squamous cell carcinoma. At this point of this presentation, it's important to remember that head and neck cancers are a real plague, despite a low relevance in social media and low knowledge in common people, mainly in Western Europe. It represents the fifth most common group of neoplasia worldwide, with almost 7,000 of new cases per year, and almost 4,000 of deaths directly attributable to it. Differently from other human body regions, the year rate of new cases is stable or even increasing, largely due to oropharyngeal cancer in youngs. The oral site is the most common affected subsite, accounting for 42% of all the cases, and squamous cell cancer is the most common histological type. As a whole, oral cavity is made up of different distinguished subsides. This division is not only descriptive, but has to keep in mind when the general treatment has to be planned. The different oral cavity subsides have different and specific anatomical characteristics, different pattern of local and regional spread, and different trend to lymphatic and blood metastatic diffusion. For each of them, different surgical routes with different complexity and reconstructive challenges have to be considered and administered. Among all the subsides, primary intraosseous squamous cell carcinoma represents a very real disease. It accounts for 1-2% of all the oral cavity squamous cell carcinoma. Males are more affected than females, and the age at diagnosis is around the fifth decade of life. It origins from intraosseous residual odontogenic epithelial cells, and it may arise from both from benign lesions and less frequently de novo. Due to their origin from inside mandibular bone, these lesions are not dependent from common risk factors such as smoke and alcohol abuse, and so their biological behavior show peculiar features with a five-year survival rate of less than 40%. Despite this aggressive behavior, no specific symptoms are usually present, and diagnosis at early stage is quite impossible. Frequently, a final diagnosis is made after an unhealed cyst removal and or tooth extraction, when all the other possible origin sites are excluded. At this point, patients usually present a stage 4 disease, requiring a very aggressive treatment in a multimodality fashion. Looking back at our case, due to masseter infiltration and the high nodal stage, the disease was classified as PT4B and 2B. And according to NCCN guidelines and our experience, we chose for a neoadjuvant treatment. Patient underwent cycles of TPF, and in this slide, you can appreciate the good response at T and then site, either at the end of third cycle. The case was discussed again in our tumor board, and the radical surgical treatment was the chosen option. The surgical plan relies on a radical resection involving all the structure involved before the new adjuvant treatment. So in this specific clinical case, an hemimandibulectomy involving the extended to cheek mucosa, masticatory muscles, and lateral floor of the mouth and block with a radical modified neck dissection was planned. Due to the young patient's age and the absence of any comorbidities, a free flap reconstruction was considered as well. The goal of any surgical oncologic procedure is the complete clearance of the lesion, of course. This should be accomplished with free margins of at least 1.5 centimeters. In cases of positive neck or in higher risk lesions, an en-bloc resection of TNN should always be attempted. At the end of the ablative procedure, frozen sections are mandatory, and in any doubtful case, wider margins should be obtained. Remember that we always perform surgery on the face, and so the less invasive procedure with higher chances of radicality should be administered. The gaining of free wide margins must be the first and most valuable goal of any surgical procedures. Just remember that an involved margin represents one of the worst prognostic factors, whatever is the stage of the tumor. In this slide, you may appreciate how clear margins should be obtained. A circumferential resection of the lesion has to be performed, and the tumor clear in an en-bloc fashion with an end dissection. As I mentioned before, even in advanced cases as the one we are discussing, it is our philosophy to always avoid any unnecessary scar in the face, of course, when it's possible. We never perform lip split excision or, in case of soft tissue oral cavity cancer, a mandibulotomy. We always go for a lateral or total visor flap approach or a puncture resection whenever mandible is not involved. Despite these minimal approaches, our free resection margins rate accounts for less than 1% for all oral cavity cancer. Another key point of the high-stage oral cavity cancer treatment is the need of performing an accurate neck dissection. We well know the importance of neck disease on affecting overall survival. Many studies have shown the necessity to identify different prognostic errors related to neck dissection. Among them, the number of dissected nodes needed to define an adequate lymphadenectomy was identified as number 18. Patients with an ODL measured than 18 have a better overall survival. The need of a block resection relies on the need of the resection of the T and N tract. This anatomic area represents the fourth route of spreading of cancer cells from the oral cavity to neck. Many different anatomic structures surrounded by lymph nodes are present in this tract, and in order to have a comprehensive resection, they have always to be cleared out. In fact, the eventual presence of pathologic nodes in TN tract impacts negatively on disease-free and overall survival, predisposing to higher rate of local and distant relapses. Higher stage PT4 disease and involvement of floor of the mouth and tongue muscle should always require an unblocked resection. And so, in our opinion, it's always mandatory to perform an unblocked resection of primary and neck dissection for all oral cavity subsides, but except hard palate and upper alveolar ridges. A complete management of an advanced oral cavity cancer should always encompass a reconstructive phase. Mandibular reconstruction is common and well-known procedures in head and neck and maxillofacial surgery. However, despite the huge number of procedures performed, it still may represent a challenge, and this is because whatever is the origin, the different amount of composite tissue involved make each resection different from the others. Restoration of the bone continuity and its surrounding tissues are the keys to achieve the best functional outcomes. And this is why bone-containing free flaps such as iliac crest, fibula, and scapula represent the workhorse options in mandibular reconstruction. In order to choose the best reconstruction, in our institution, we build a simple classification system, a reconstructive algorithm that is based on the concept that each mandible defect may be extensively described by a combination of three main features: the extent of bone defect, the amount of soft tissues that have to be reconstructed, and the availability of ipsilateral neck vessels. And for each main defect feature, different classes were recognized, and the combination of them gives rise to a specific class of defect with specific reconstructive demands. For each class of defect, a decisional algorithm is present that guides the surgeon to the best reconstructive options. Giving a quick look to our classification, bone defect is described based on the concept of the four angles suggested by Professor Brown, but with some modification. The defect is subdivided in five different classes. Each of them represents a specific mandibular subunits or a combination of them. And with increasing level or size of defect and the consequent reconstructive challenges, and possible related complications. Differently for many of the other classifications, we did not mention to the condyle or make a specific subclasses for its resection. This concept relies on functional and reconstructive considerations. Whenever the condyle is involved in resections, TNJ ligaments, articular disc and disc ligaments, temporalis, and lateral pterygoid muscle attachments are usually resected as well. Whatever reconstructive technique is used, only a rotational movement may be restored with limited functional outcome. The soft tissue deficit is a topic underinvestigated and considered marginal in many suggestive reconstructive schemes. On the contrary, it is our thoughts that its management plays a primary role in oromandibular reconstruction. The soft tissue surface volume requirements should always be assessed. In particular, tongue involvement creates a specific subclass in which the volume needed cannot be addressed with a simple skilled paddle. Looking back to our patient treatment, we performed a radical right hemimandibulotomy, mandibulectomy, extended to masticatory space, lower third cheek mucosa, floor of the mouth, and radical modified neck dissection. The histological report showed a PT4N1 disease with signs of perineural spread and clear margin resection. As you can see, our reconstructive option was a DCIA free flap. In these graphs, we summarize the use of DCIA with respect to our classification scheme. As you can see, differently from many other centers, we perform a large use of DCIA flap. This flap is our workhorse flap from mild to moderate oromandibular defects. In particular, whenever a large soft tissue reconstruction is needed, the choice of this flap relies on the possibility to harvest the internal oblique muscle linked to the iliac bone. The muscle component of the flap is very useful in close to the oral neck communication and fill the residual dead space. In order to make easier the harvesting and insetting of the DCIA, we developed some surgical tips that we routinely use in our daily practice. First of all, we always preserve the anterior spine in order to guarantee not only a better aesthetic outcome, but also a dramatic reduction of postoperative pain and gait disturbance. Then we strictly harvest the skin paddle for through and through defects only. In all other cases, when only the intraoral lining is required, we recommend the use of the internal oblique muscle. We usually inset the flap with the pedicle in the lingual side and coming off posteriorly, because in this way the pedicle lies in a more safety position and the anastomosis is more comfortable, avoiding excessive manipulation of the vessels. In order to get this insetting, we harvest the DCIA from the contralateral hip in cases of lateral defects not involving the ramus. Otherwise, in case of large defects involving the ramus, B3 defects, for example, the homolateral DCIA is harvested. In such way, the internal oblique muscle maintains its natural relationship with the bone, avoiding dangerous ascending branch twisting. Some authors advocate the donor side morbidity as major contraindication for this kind of flap. In 2009, our group published this paper showing the low rate of morbidities coming from flap harvesting. Since then, only other two major complications were experienced, confirmed that the DCIA may be considered a flap of choice for donor side morbidity. Turning back to our case, in consideration of the histological report, our patient started a combined multimodality adjuvant treatment. Unfortunately, 6 months after treatment, we experienced the double site relapse, one in the neck at level 5 and the other in the infratemporal fossa. Given the previous modality, multimodality treatment, the only valuable option was represented by a new surgical procedure. And so, as you can see, we performed a radical resection with zygomatic curve sacrifice via temporal approach and resection on the neck relapse that implies accessory nerve resection and immediate reconstruction via an interpositional nerve graft. The histological reports revealed that two sites relapse of previous disease. In particular, I would like to underline that the small lesion in the neck is not a clear metastatic nodes, but a direct infiltration of muscle or the connective tissue by the cancer cells. After the last surgery, the patient started a straight follow-up regimen, and luckily he is now 26 months free of disease. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Valentini, for the excellent presentation. I enjoyed it. That's your team. They look like they're a very happy group of people. I have one question for you and for the group as well. It's from Razvan, and I would probably not pronounce their last name very well. So let me just give it to you. He asked for a few more words on post-surgery reconstruction, but especially since he follows with interest the developments of software from Materialize Belgium and Mimics to build personalized prosthetics in such cases. So I wonder if you could comment on that, Valentino, and then maybe somebody else can pick that up if they wish. And ask you any questions. Just very briefly, we don't have too much time, but thank you.
Yes, thank you so much for the kind question. When it's possible, whenever it's possible, we use the CAD/CAM for a better reconstruction. Of course, in malignant cases, sometimes we have not so much time. So the only problem is the time. If it's possible, and very often it's possible to obtain a prosthesis, a guide, a CAD/CAM guide for a resection for the flap. We use always the CAD/CAM, especially, of course, in young patients.
Okay, great. Thank you. Anybody else want to comment on that?
I think now we have our production is very fast, and I cannot remember of a case that we did without a prefabricated plate and cutting guides. So that has been the big difference in the time of production. In the past, it used to be a couple of weeks. Now it's less than a week. So we have a very fast turnover. So it's very beneficial for the patients.
Okay, good. I think we have time just for one brief question from the panelists. If they are, I think I have another question. Oh, just somebody saying thank you for the answer. But anybody with a comment or a question from our panel? Okay, well, I think the presentation, Colin.
I was only going to say that was very nice, the last presentation. I enjoyed it. I do a bit of medico-legal work, as does my colleague, and between us, we have seen half a dozen over the last 2 years cases. Not necessarily primary intraosseous, but problems around a wisdom tooth where the tooth's been taken out. And sometimes there's a diagnostic delay of 6 months before the mandible seem to be falling apart with tumor involvement. So it really is, the fact that the dentist didn't biopsy it in the first place is a very salutary lesson. And you'll end up in court if you don't.
Thanks for the comment.
It's very important to perform, of course, an histologic examination. This was a very great mistake from the dentist, of course.
Okay, I think we've had really a terrific session today, and I want to thank the distinguished presenters and for their excellent presentations. I have to just give a special hello to Ria in St. Albans, and she knows who she is, and so hi, Ria. And she said I was looking too serious, so I had to make that. And I want to just also welcome the Meharry people because they've been with us, and it's very enjoyable. Remember that there is a poll that appears on the screen for everybody, so please complete the poll if you wish to have your CE credits, so they'll be sent to you. And once again, thanks to all for great presentations, and we look forward to the 7th Eastman International Alliance Global Rounds in May. So bye to everybody in Rome, in London, in Stockholm, and from Rochester.
Have a great day. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for your kind invitation.
Thank you.